Thanks for joining our special live coverage of President Yoon Suk-yeol's visit to the Indo-Pacific Command in Hawaii. I'm Kim Dami in Seoul. President Yoon is about to make his speech at the island state, but before, the very first stop he made in Hawaii was a symbolic memorial cemetery where he paid his respects to Korean War veterans. Our correspondent Kim Do-yeon has the details.
Kicking off his U.S. trip in Hawaii on Monday, President Yoon Suk-yeol visited the National Memorial Cemetery of the Pacific, also informally known as the Punch Bowl. Around 10,000 Korean War veterans and their families have been laid to rest there, including Benjamin Wilson, who received a U.S. Medal of Honor for his courageous actions during the war.
President Yoon expressed the highest respect for the noble sacrifice and dedication of the U.S. veterans who willingly gave their lives for the freedom and peace of South Korea when the fate of the nation was at stake over 70 years ago.
This could be seen as a build-up to the main reason he's stopping by Hawaii before heading to Washington, D.C. for the NATO summit. President Yoon, on day two of his trip, will visit the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command here in Honolulu, where he'll be briefed by the commander regarding ongoing security issues in the region. It's the first time for a South Korean president to visit the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command since it changed its name from the Pacific Command back in 2018. And if you count the Pacific Command as well, it's the first time in 29 years.
U.S. Indo-PACOM covers the Indo-Pacific region, 52% of the Earth's surface, and has the largest responsibility among six regional unified combatant commands. U.S. Forces Korea is also under this command, so it has a pivotal role in peace on the Korean Peninsula.
Meanwhile, the largest daily newspaper in Hawaii, the Honolulu Star-Advertiser, had President Yoon's visit on its first page this morning, emphasizing his visit to the U.S. Indo-PACOM. The paper focused on regional security issues, especially with Russia and North Korea strengthened military cooperation as well as Russia and China's naval cooperation. Also while in Hawaii, President Yoon took the time to meet overseas Koreans. Hawaii is where the first South Korean immigrants moved to 120 years ago to start the history of Korean Americans. He showed his appreciation for them and vowed to better support overseas Koreans going forward. Kim Do-yeon, Arirang News, Honolulu.
As President Yoon stops by Hawaii en route to the NATO summit in D.C., he is visiting the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command headquarters in Honolulu. Before he makes a speech to encourage soldiers, we connect with our correspondent Woo Soo-young, who is traveling with the president. Hello there, Soo-young.
Hi, Tommy.
So, President Yoon's speech is to begin in just minutes. But first, it's been less than a day since he arrived on the shores of Hawaii. How significant is this stopover?
It's very significant, Tommy, because the island state is home to the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command, which covers just over half of the Earth's surface. And that makes it the largest of the U.S.'s six geographically unified combatant commands, with around 375,000 military and civilian personnel. And now this includes the Korean Peninsula, where some 28,500 U.S. troops are stationed. The National Memorial Cemetery of the Pacific, known as the Punch Bowl, is also in Hawaii, where the remains of 60,000 veterans from the World War II, the Korean War, and the Vietnam War are buried. Now, the president and his wife, Kim Gon-hee, they laid a wreath to honor them on Monday and also met with surviving Korean War veterans to personally thank them for their dedication and courage. So as you can see, Hawaii is very much at the core of the South Korea-U.S. alliance. Controlling the U.S.'s key strategic assets, such as aircraft carriers, nuclear submarines, and bombers, the Indo-Pacific Command also facilitates Washington's promise of extended deterrence. Now, that's its policy of coming to the aid of its allies under conventional or nuclear attack. But of course, as South Korea plans to broaden its role for peace and stability in the wider Indo-Pacific region by cooperating with the United States as well as Japan on various fronts, from security and economic resilience to climate action and development, visiting the very heart of Washington's military predominance of the region is truly significant.
Indeed. We will hear from him directly, of course, but what will his message actually convey or even signify?
Well, of course, as you said, we have to wait and see. But we're guessing that his words of encouragement will, well, it really comes at a time of heightened tensions in the region due to the developments we've seen in Russia and North Korea's military cooperation. Their recent military treaty to aid each other in the face of aggression and the North's delivery of an estimated 11,000 containers of ammunition, according to US sources, poses a threat not only to the Indo-Pacific, but also more broadly to Ukraine and liberal democracies everywhere in support of Kyiv. So President Yoon's message is likely to signal South Korea's commitment to enhancing regional security by working more closely with the US on its Indo-Pacific missions. As the speech will come just before he takes off for the NATO summit in DC, his words are also going to take on global importance, I would say, and also according to the observers that I spoke to. Why don't we take a listen?
By engaging with both Indo-Pacific Command and NATO, President Yoon highlights the interconnected nature of Indo-Pacific and transatlantic security, promoting a comprehensive defense strategy. This conveys a message of solidarity and cooperation with the key military alliances, reinforcing South Korea's position as a pivotal security partner committed to maintaining stability and peace on a global scale.
By visiting Indo-PACOM, President Yoon may signal that South Korea may do more for the maritime security beyond the region of Korean Peninsula, in South China Sea and in the Taiwan Strait. That does not necessarily mean that South Korea will participate in military exercise, but there may be something that South Korea can contribute by supporting Vietnam or Southeast Asian countries' coast guard capabilities or equipment.
That's what the experts had to say. So I believe we're just minutes away from hearing his speech now. So we'll be covering you. We'll be keeping you updated, of course, with our coverage.
Please do. Thank you always for your reports, Young.
Thanks very much, Tavi.
Now, in the meantime, the 2024 NATO summit has officially kicked off in Washington, D.C. The 75th edition will again be all about tackling security issues around the world, from supporting Ukraine to dealing with China and its growing aggression. Pinzi reports.
The North Atlantic Treaty Organization was founded in 1949 to counter the Soviet Union during the Cold War. A dozen countries, including the U.S., Canada, and 10 from Europe, signed the treaty at the time. This year, NATO marks 75 years since its founding and has now grown into the world's biggest military organization with 32 members. The leaders of these member states are set to meet this week in Washington, D.C. for 3 days, starting Tuesday. NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said the summit, which comes at a critical time for European security, will focus on three major topics. First is providing more support to Ukraine. As the NATO chief arrived at the Pentagon in Washington on Monday local time, he said Russia must accept a solution where Ukraine prevails as a sovereign nation.
At the summit, we'll make decisions to further strengthen our support to Ukraine, and Russia must understand that they're not able to wait those out.
He also said the leaders will also address boosting NATO's defense and deterrence, as well as investment, noting that he welcomes a record of 23 allies making the decision to invest at least 2% of their GDP in defense. Also on the agenda will be NATO's efforts to strengthen its global partnerships, especially in the Indo-Pacific region.
We also have the leaders of the Asia-Pacific partners, Australia, New Zealand, Japan and South Korea, present at the summit. That demonstrates that our security is not regional, our security is global.
Last week, Japanese media reported that NATO is planning to release its first joint document on expanding security cooperation with four Asia-Pacific nations: South Korea, Japan, Australia and New Zealand, in an apparent move to counter military threats from China. The document is expected to contain detailed information on cooperation frameworks between NATO and the four countries, including cybersecurity and disinformation. This week's summit will be Stoltenberg's last as he hands over the reins to the outgoing Dutch Prime Minister, Mark Rutte. Last month, NATO appointed Rutte as its new Secretary General to lead the organization starting in October. Meanwhile, the summit is the first since Sweden and Finland formally joined NATO. Sweden officially became the group's 32nd member in March, and Finland joined the organization in April 2023. Pyeongs, Arirang News.
So, President Yoon is at the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command. It looks like he has just arrived to deliver his speech, which will be focusing on encouraging soldiers there. Why don't we come back after his speech?
인도태평양 사령부의 장병 여러분, 정말 반갑습니다. 미국에서 가장 오래되고 가장 규모가 큰 통합 전투 사령부이자 지구 절반 이상의 광활한 지역을 책임지고 있는 인도태평양 사령부를 이렇게 찾게 돼서 매우 기쁘게 생각합니다. 파파로 사령관과 육해공군 해병대 구성문 사령관을 비롯한 장병 여러분의 환대에 감사드립니다.
Fellow members of the Indo-Pacific Command, it is my pleasure to visit Indo-PACOM, the oldest and largest unified combatant command in the U.S. military, whose theater of operations covers more than half of Earth's surface. Admiral Paparo, component commanders, and all sailors, soldiers, airmen, and marines, thank you for your warm hospitality.
조금 전 작전 현황을 브리핑 받으면서 영내 평화와 안정을 지키는데 인태사의 역할이 정말 중요하다는 것을 다시 한번 확실히 느꼈습니다.
As I was briefed on current operations minutes ago, I saw firsthand the critical importance that the Indo-PACOM is playing in protecting peace and stability in the region.
특히 전시와 평시 한반도 연합방위 태세 유지에 인태사가 핵심적인 역할을 담당하고 있음을 다시 확인했습니다.
In particular, I once again was reminded of the crucial role that Indo-PACOM plays in maintaining combined defense posture on the ground and as well as in peacetime and wartime.
인도태평양 사령부는 한미 연합 방위 태세를 지원하고 한반도 유사시 미 증원 전력의 전개에 중심적 역할을 수행하는 한미 동맹의 대들보입니다.
Among many other important missions, Indo-PACOM supports throughout U.S. combined combat readiness and plays a central role in providing and deploying U.S. augmentation in case of contingency on the Korean Peninsula. It is indeed the central pillar of throughout U.S. alliance.
저는 오늘 대한민국 현직 대통령으로서 29년 만에 인태사령부를 방문했습니다.
Today I am visiting Indo-PACOM for the first time in 29 years as Korean president.
엄중한 국제정세와 한반도 안보 상황 속에 철통같은 한미동맹과 우리의 연합방위 태세를 확고히 다지기 위한 것입니다.
I stand here amid grave global geopolitical situation and instability on the Korean Peninsula because visiting no other place can better demonstrate and strengthen our ironclad alliance and robust combined defense posture than coming to the Indo-PACOM.
북한 정권은 주민들의 처참한 삶을 외면한 채 핵과 미사일 능력을 고도화하고 핵의 선제 사용을 법제화했습니다. 또한 북한은 러시아와 불법적인 무기 거래를 통해 한반도는 물론 세계의 평화를 위협하고 있습니다.
The North Korean regime is turning a blind eye to the dire life conditions of its residents, and the regime is obsessed with maintaining its power and domestic control, advancing its nuclear missile capabilities, and passing new law that enables preemptive use of nuclear weapons. Moreover, through its illegal arms deal with Russia, North Korea is posing threat to peace on the Korean Peninsula and beyond.
지난달에는 러시아와 포괄적 전략적 동반자 관계에 관한 조약을 체결하고 군사 경제 협력을 강화하여 국제사회의 우려를 더욱 깊게 하고 있습니다.
Last month, Pyongyang signed a treaty on comprehensive strategic partnership with Moscow and pledged to strengthen their military and economic cooperation, raising concerns of the international community.
이러한 무모한 세력으로부터 우리의 자유와 민주주의, 경제적 번영을 지켜내기 위해서는 강력한 힘과 함께 가치 공유국 간의 연대가 필수적입니다.
In order to defend our freedoms, democracy, and prosperity from those reckless actors, we need strength, and countries who share common values must unite in solidarity.
작년 8월 한미일 3국은 캠프 데이비드에서 정상회의를 통해 한미일 3국 협력의 새 시대를 열었습니다. 그리고 지난 6월 캠프 데이비드 합의에 따라 한미일 3국 최초의 다영역 군사훈련인 프리덤 엣지 훈련이 성공적으로 수행되었습니다. 저는 훈련을 위해 방한한 시어도 루스벨트 항거에 승선하여 미국의 확고한 방위 공약과 태세를 제 눈으로 확인했습니다.
In August last year, the Republic of Korea, the U.S. and Japan opened a new era of trilateral partnership at the Camp David Summit. And last month, as part of the follow-up measures of the summit, the Freedom Edge exercise, the first ever multi-domain trilateral exercise, was conducted successfully. Before the exercise, I was aboard USS Teddy Roosevelt and witnessed the robust U.S. commitment and preparedness to defending Korea.
또한 지금 이 시간 이곳 하와이 근해에서는 대한민국의 율곡이함과 미국 칼빈슨 항모를 비롯해서 한미 양국과 우방국들이 참여하는 가운데 작전 능력과 상호 운용성을 강화하는 림팩 훈련이 진행되고 있습니다.
Also at this moment in Hawaiian waters, the RIMPAC exercise is taking place, joined by the ROC Navy's DDG 992 and U.S. Navy's USS Carl Vinson, and many Navy vessels from the ROK, the U.S. and other partners, with the aim of enhancing operation capabilities and interoperability.
공고한 공약과 협력의 토대를 둔 강력한 능력이야말로 규범에 기반한 역내 질서를 굳건하게 수호하는 원동력입니다. 그리고 그 근간에 바로 인태사령부가 있습니다.
Strong capabilities undergirded by rock-solid commitment and close cooperation are the true driving force defending the rules-based order in the region based on our values and norms, and Indo-PACOM is at the very heart of this effort.
인태사 장병 여러분의 헌신과 노력이 강력한 한미 동맹과 한미일 협력, 그리고 국제사회의 연대를 이끄는 진정한 힘입니다.
The dedication and hard work of all service members of Indo-PACOM is the true foundation of strong ROC-US alliance, Korea-US-Japan trilateral cooperation, and the unity of the international community.
한미 동맹과 연합 방위 태세 강화, 그리고 역내 평화를 위한 인태사령부와 이하 구성군 사령부의 기여에 다시 한번 감사드리고 장병 여러분에게 무한한 신뢰를 보냅니다.
I once again thank the Indo-PACOM and its component commands for your contribution to strengthening the alliance, enhancing combined defense, and promoting peace in the region. I put absolute trust in you.
파파로 사령관님의 지휘 지침이 압도적 승리, 프리베일이라고 알고 있습니다. 인태사가 늘 전장을 지배하고 승리하는 사령부가 될 것이라고 확신합니다. 감사합니다.
Like Admiral Paparo's command motto, prevail, I am more than confident that Indo-PACOM will always prevail on the ground, at sea, and in the air. Thank you very much.
That was our special live coverage of President Yoon Suk-yeol's message encouraging members of the American Armed Forces at the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command. If you missed it, we'll have highlights in our upcoming newscast at 9 a.m. Korea time. Thanks for watching.